Okay. Hi, everybody. My name's Chris Stevens. I've been at Netflix for about just over 9 years. I work on the content data engineering team. Our team turns billions of streaming hours into actionable insights that Netflix can use to help bring our members the world's best films and series. It's a fun space. I get to work with movies and TV all day. I've never been able to say that in my career. That's what keeps me here day after day. This is Pedro Duarte. He's my presentation partner today. Pedro's been here for about a year and a half. He's on Netflix's Consolidated Logging team. At Netflix, Consolidated Logging just means that they're the team that collect events from the millions and millions of events that are generated by our hundreds of millions of users. Coming from the thousands of different types of devices that are all running Netflix software, our consolidated logging team brings all that information together in kind of a very reasonable way and makes the data understandable. They've gotten so good at this that we actually now use the same consolidated logging services for logging behavioral events for lots of Netflix's internal apps. It's a very complex space and very fun to work. So what we're going to talk about today is Netflix's data engineering stack. This is just the tools and technologies that we use to produce analytic data. The problem with talking about Netflix's data engineering stack is it's very large. We have a lot of tools. So Netflix started building our analytic data warehouse in 2007, just shortly after we started video streaming. And in going from zero to over 200 million members, we've built tools and technology to help with just about every aspect of our data engineering practice. So I promise this morning we are not going to try to cover every single tool. Instead, we're just going to talk through a typical pipeline implementation. We're going to talk about the ways that the Netflix data engineering stack tries to make the most common things that we need to do easy. And also, when we do need to do something custom that's kind of off the paved path, we allow for that customization at multiple levels, starting high and kind of drilling deeper, so that we don't always have to go back and build things from raw primitives from scratch. I'm going to talk a little bit about the process of building batch pipelines. Pedro's going to talk this morning about building streaming. And just one more note on the audience for this talk. This talk is definitely geared towards folks who are new to Netflix. If you've been working as a data engineer at Netflix for quite a while, you're going to be familiar with a lot of components of this tech stack, probably more so on the batch side or the real-time streaming side, depending on which side you usually work on. If you've been here for a while and you're listening with one ear open, we don't hold that against you at all. But if you are new to Netflix, hoping that you can walk away learning about a couple of different components of our stack that maybe you hadn't heard of before, and with some things that you can take back to your team and get some. Okay, so let's start talking about batch pipeline implementation. So assuming you've already done a great job of understanding what your stakeholders need, and assuming that you've already figured out how the data set that you're working with plugs into the larger Netflix data ecosystem, and that you've designed tables that conform to our shared table standards, that's a plug for Go table standards. If you haven't been out there, please look them up. So assuming that you've done all of those things, here's some of the areas that you might look at to build a batch pipeline. So first, how do we implement our transformation in aggregate? So I guess stepping back, Netflix's analytic data warehouse consists of thousands of tables, Apache Iceberg tables that are backed by cloud storage. These tables cover all aspects of Netflix's business. We have data on video streaming, on interaction with product features, customer service, studio operations, marketing. Just about every aspect of Netflix's business is represented in our analytic data warehouse. Today, almost all of our batch pipelines are implemented using Apache Spark. That's how we build those iceberg tables. Netflix has an active community of data engineers using the three most common Spark bindings, SQL, PySpark, and Scala. The important thing, I think, for people who are a little bit new to Netflix to know is that all of these bindings receive first-class support from our platform, and all of them have an active community of engineers at Netflix. So while teams have preferences and tend to use one or two of them, if for a particular job, you need the high performance and you need to be the first on your team to kind of build a Scala pipeline, or you've got something simple to do, it's more business logic than your team normally does, you're going to implement it in SQL, you're going to find an active community of data engineers within this org who do that. And it's okay to step away from your team's lane. Talking about a couple of useful tools in our stack for pipeline implementation. If you are doing development or analysis in SQL, most of our data engineers, just like our analysts, go to Netflix's Big Data Portal query UI. Got a couple of nice features where it will detect the tables that you're referencing inside of a query and pull up the documentation on those tables for you. It does autocomplete for all of the Netflix columns and Netflix functions, including diving into nested structures like structs, and allows you to query all of our processing engines from one UI and switch back and forth between using Spark, Trino, you can query Druid and Snowflake without switching. Another kind of useful tool when doing development is GoBoost. We see a couple of more senior people here laughing at that. So Netflix has a culture of freedom and responsibility. And part and parcel with that, Netflix tries to provide tooling to let individuals make decisions about how much resources they need to get something done. So if you're under the gun to get a pipeline finished, maybe you have a stakeholder who needs a what-if analysis more urgently than they need the rest of the pipeline done, you can go out to GoBoost and increase your share of resources on the cluster temporarily for a couple of days so that you can get your work done. I want to note here that you can go the other way too. If you're running, say, a large backfill job and you want to do it on the production cluster, you should specify that you want to run in the root backfill cluster queue. That way your long-running backfill job isn't trying to take resources from the daily jobs that run in our normal SLA. Okay, let's talk a little bit about code and data quality. So Netflix has a pretty mature data quality ecosystem. We've definitely tried to get beyond the garbage in, garbage out mentality, and we try to have our data engineers take more responsibility for ensuring that the data in our analytic data warehouse can be trusted by all stakeholders. So we tend to use unit tests and data audits to help ensure that quality. But the goal is using each of these things so that we maximize the protection that our data sets get for the amount of time and resources that we're investing. And that goes into your decision about whether unit tests or audits are going to be more appropriate and kind of maximize the protection you get. When it comes to unit tests, I most often see them used for user-defined functions and for complex transformations. For user-defined functions, native unit test libraries tend to work just fine. For cases when you want to do unit tests on Spark's data frame APIs, Netflix does provide a couple of different Spark unit testing libraries. I also want to note that Netflix's data flow tool helps you pull data out of tables in our analytic data warehouse and save them off into mock files to make it easier and faster to rerun unit tests when you need to. Holden's going to be talking a little bit more about some of Netflix's Spark unit test libraries later on this morning. We also set up a lot of audits against our data. This is not checking necessarily the quality of our code, but checking something I think happens more often here at Netflix, and that is the context behind the data that you've been sourcing might change. And our data engineers don't always get a heads up that this is going to happen before it happens. So really important that we have good data auditing on our data sets. We lean heavily into something that we call the WAP pattern, where we first write data to a hidden iceberg snapshot. We can run audits on that data and then only publish the data or make that snapshot the current snapshot once all of those audits have passed. It's important to note that during the publish step, there's no copying of data. This is important not only because some of our data sets are pretty large, but because we are rebuilding lots of data sets every day. And even if it wasn't very expensive to do on a small data set, doing it across lots and lots of workflows is the kind of thing that would cause drag on our platform. So the Netflix Data Auditor package provides a lot of out-of-the-box audits for kind of the common things that data engineers need to do, checking the keys are unique, checking for nulls. But it also provides mechanisms for data engineers to write context-specific audits. That is, making sure that films don't have multiple episodes, making sure that titles that are showing up in our top 10, these generally are the titles that have high play starts and vice versa. So a couple of tips on how to use Data Auditor. If I'm in a hurry and need to get a pipeline stood up before I've had time to kind of look through the data thoroughly and think through all of those context-specific audits, my two favorite audits to place on a pipeline first for dimensions is the table value change tolerance audit. This makes sure that the categorical values on your dimensions, only a certain percentage of them change every day. I can't tell you how many times this has helped me catch, all of our movies suddenly turning from being series to standalone because of a problem upstream. By default, the audit covers all columns on your table, and you can opt out for columns where you expect more change than typical on a given day. The other tip is looking at the amount of context-specific audits you have. Sometimes you'll inherit a pipeline where the previous engineer didn't write any context-specific audits. Or maybe you put something in production where you've only implemented kind of the widely applicable audits like primary key checks. This is usually an indicator that either the person who was working with the data set before or you don't understand your data well enough. Almost every pipeline can afford to have some audits that are specific to the context of that data set. So if you can't think of anything, think about what your stakeholders care about. If they're always looking at the top end that comes out of a data set, maybe those are the things that you need to double check more closely. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about our job scheduling and monitoring tooling. Netflix has a custom built workflow and job scheduler we call Maestro. We have tens of thousands of workflows scheduled and running through Maestro every day. Part of the reason that it's custom built is so that it can support the scale that Netflix operates at. So Maestro lets you specify when and how frequently jobs run, whether they're triggered by events or on a time schedule, what data signals the job should wait for before it's released, and what steps need to be run. Almost everyone I see uses the declarative YAML domain-specific language, but it also has a programmatic Python domain-specific language you need to generate workflows programmatically. Maestro has a lot of out-of-the-box scheduler job steps to do the most common things that data engineers need to do. Almost all of these are configuration-only or low-code, so that they don't take a lot of effort to kind of get spun up. But there's plenty of times when a data engineer needs to write something custom. When you do need to write a custom step in your workflow, you don't always have to go straight to a low-level API or to a vendor-specific API that has different semantics from everything else that you're used to using. Instead, Netflix provides a series of programmatic APIs for almost all of the systems in our ecosystem, so that you can use a single API for, say, querying all of the different databases that we have available. for getting access to a table property, or for sending a signal with a custom payload. Most of these APIs, in addition to having a Python SDK, also have gRPC bindings, if that works. If you haven't implemented, written a big data API script, we recommend going out to Go Craggle Docs. That's probably the most commonly used API and is probably where you should. Another thing that I'll note about our ecosystem is that almost all of the events from the tools that I've mentioned so far, the logs are ingested into our analytic data warehouse and put into to pretty clean, ready-to-use iceberg tables. So this means scheduler workflow and step execution, data auditor results. We capture all of that history for basically all time. So anytime you want to, you can go back and look at the history of data audits and see what's happened. We've got data on table usage, on table lineage. So I always recommend going and looking at what's already not only logged, but is cleanly modeled in our data warehouse before you do your own instrumentation, because a lot of what you're looking for long-term trend analysis may already be. Okay, and lastly, data management tools. Netflix has got several of them, a couple that I'll highlight. Netflix has a cost insights dashboard, DLM dash. This helps you look at the platform cost, both in terms of compute time and storage costs for the pipelines that you're implementing. Lets you aggregate these costs by team and by organization, by job type. It also lets you get access to top end lists, so that if you want to look at what jobs do we think have the most opportunity for us to save some of our shared resource usage, you can go to those top end. Netflix also has an aggressive data janitor. If I could have, I would have found like a picture of like a mean janitor that I could put in there. But the aggressive janitor is not mean. It's actually very useful. It just goes and cleans up data sets that haven't been referenced. So the classic example of this is if you did a lot of development work in a personal schema, you stop running those flows because you've moved things to production. If you don't reference those tables for a while, our janitor will go and delete them because we don't need that data just sitting around for the next 5 years. It's best to get rid of it. The aggressive janitor also helps enforce Netflix's data retention policies so that engineers don't need to build all of those policies into our code. If you don't know about Netflix's data retention rules, go back today and ask somebody on your team. I'm sure they'd be willing to tell y'all. So that's it for the batch side of things. Now I'm going to ask Pedro to come up and tell you a little bit more about real-time and streaming pipeline.
Thank you, Chris. So I'm going to tell you today a little bit about real-time data. And from the perspective of my team, I work in Consolidated Logging, and these are systems that we use a lot to build our solutions. So I'll start by telling you about how we build stream processing applications. At Netflix, Apache Flink has been the paved path for a number of years to build stream processing applications. And as data engineers, we get a lot of support from the real-time data platform teams to be able to run and operate Flink jobs, Flink applications at scale. So the data platform provides tooling for us to not have to worry about how to launch our jobs, how to acquire compute resources. So the platform will provide very sane custom defaults for the compute resources. And it has the ability to talk to underlying systems in Netflix that are used to deploy containers and manage clusters. And at the same time, these Flink jobs come built in with tools for observability, alerting, managing configuration, setting fast properties so you can dynamically change the behavior of your jobs. And then also a lot of metrics, not only metrics that are standard across all Flink jobs, but metrics that you can customize and send out from your application. There's also a control plane abstraction, the streaming platform as a service. It's in the form of a web UI that you could use day to day to manage your Flink applications. So from the UI, you could control things like what AWS regions your jobs are being deployed to. You can see the configuration history for your job and diff it. Say, sometimes you need to detect someone else from my team updated a configuration, and you can easily see that. From the control plane, you also have very useful links where you can get to the alerts that are associated with your job, dashboards that tell you about the job health, and anything you do to operate the job on a day-to-day basis. Usually, this is where we do deployments from. You can select a version of the job that you want to run on different regions, and from the UI, you can get all of that done. So it's very useful for us. Let me talk a little bit about data sources and syncs in streaming applications. So here's a typical stream processing application. You have one or more streams that you're reading data from, and some syncs that you need to write data out to. And you may have a number of data stores that you want to use as syncs. You could be writing your data to a stream for another application to consume, or some other data store for a different use case. And so at Netflix, we have a very useful abstraction or concept called Keystone Streams. And Keystone essentially lets you think about your syncs in a different way. So instead of thinking about what kind of data store you're going to be writing your data to, you could simply write it to a Keystone stream. A Keystone stream under the hood is a Kafka topic alongside with a Flink application that we call a router. This Kafka topic accepts your data, and then the Flink application, the router, can be later on configured to sync your data to one or more sources. So there's a lot of value in this because you can configure this from the control plane. You can say, I want my data to be output to Kafka for another pipeline to read as a stream, or you could configure your data to go to some other data store. You could also include filtering and projection. And so this becomes like a very useful building block to construct or compose data pipelines. The Keystone stream is a very useful interface to share data across teams. You can imagine a situation where you want to understand your data in a more statistical sense. So you have your stream processing application, but you also sync your data to Iceberg. And so you can run large scale queries to better understand the data that's flowing through your system. I want to talk a little bit about backfilling real-time data pipelines. Imagine you have a downstream Flink processing application that's reading from a Keystone stream. And for some reason, you need to run a backfill. Maybe you deployed an incorrect version of your code, or your data upstream has changed, and then as part of the recovery, you need to backfill your system. And so Keystone provides a very useful solution for this, in the sense that you could have an Iceberg sync from your Keystone source, and you could use that as a backfill source. So on the one hand, you have your Kafka topic, which is a live data source that's optimized for latency. And on the other hand, you have an Iceberg table that can be used as a backfill source that's optimized for throughput and longer retention. You could store data in Iceberg for a much longer time for a much cheaper cost. And so that comes, it becomes a very, very useful solution. And one thing that's very interesting about this solution is that it's something that was developed as a collaboration between data engineers and data platform teams. So backfilling is a problem that we deal with a lot in the data engineering world. And so we work very closely with the platform teams to implement this solution in more detail. There are a lot of details that I don't have the time to talk to in here, but in order to be able to have the Flink application see the data from the Iceberg backfill source exactly as it would have seen it from the streaming source, you have to make sure that the Iceberg sync and the Iceberg Flink source that are implemented share some conventions, include some metadata in the Iceberg table, so that then you can replay the data on your application in the same ordering as which it was received when it was received from the original stream. There's a lot more details on that on this talk that I linked here, where my colleagues Shinran and Sundaram from their data engineer and data platform teams, they collaborated on this system and they talked about it in a lot of detail in this presentation. I also want to talk a little bit about observability. And here's a problem that is common in both real-time data pipelines and also on back-end services. You are consuming data with very high throughput, individual events. There's a lot of raw data, individual fields that might be interesting, and you want sometimes to understand a very particular use case. You want to see the data for a given device or for a given user because you are debugging an incident, or you want to understand some of the properties of the data at a microscopic scale. And so here's where a tool that Netflix developed called Mantis, this is entirely open source, comes into play. Mantis allows you to run ad hoc queries against raw event data. And so the really cool insight here is that you can have an agent that listens to a stream or is running alongside a backend service. And this agent lets you receive queries from the user that's interested in looking at the data in real time to debug a problem. And then it's able to locally, according to the query, filter out and project the data so that it only sends back as a query response the events and the fields that are important for that particular ad hoc query that you care about in that moment. So this is a solution that is extremely powerful for observability patterns. We use this at Netflix for real-time detection of app quality of experience degradation. But we also use it, as I'll show a little bit in more detail later, to understand our real-time data pipelines and our systems in real time. I want to talk a little bit more about real-time data services, which is, I think, a relatively new thing that us as data engineers are starting to get into. And in order to talk about that, I wanted to use an example of a system that my team has built, which is called Pluid. And it's a profile-level user interaction data store. This is a system that combines a Flink application that is processing user interaction event data in real time. It's sessionizing it. It's applying a data model to, say, extract certain features out of the data, and then it's storing them in a persistent data store. In this case, we're using Cassandra. We also have, I'm going to highlight here a collaboration that we have with the Cloud Data Engines team, I believe that's the name, where they have a system called Data Gateway that it's like an abstraction on top of Cassandra that lets us very easily use it at scale. Now, the nice thing here is that we're storing all this data in real time, and then we can have a service, a gRPC service. So now we're not talking about something that's so closely to data platform, but something that's a little bit closer to how we develop backend services at Netflix using technologies like Spring Boot and gRPC to provide access to this data in real time. So a service like this can give you a historical perspective of the data that you can use for offline model training, but it can also give you a live perspective of what is happening for an individual profile, providing the features that are needed to serve recommendations in real time. And so we see that this is a pattern, real-time data services is a pattern that starting to become more common. So we're using combining tools from the big data world and processing data at scale with using them as part of a product in real time. I want to kind of wrap everything up, or the building blocks that we use for constructing real-time data systems at Netflix, by telling you a little bit more about how consolidated logging works and how our team puts these systems together to come up with a consolidated logging solution. So here I show data coming in from Netflix clients. It gets ingested into Kafka. We have a Flink application that we use to enrich and process this data. We output that data to another Kafka stream. And at this point, we rely on Mantis for observability. So when a UI engineer is developing a change or implementing logging in the client, they want to be able to see how the changes that they're making in their code for the UI are reflected in the events that are logging. So they can log to our test backend, and they can in real time have the data go through our actual pipelines and then observe the events that they're obtaining from the device that they're using while they're testing. This observability also works in production. Sometimes if you're debugging an issue for a given user, or if you have a specific set of devices that are problematic, you can kind of snoop into them using Mantis. And our team provides a lot of tools to use Mantis queries and then provide a visualization layer on top of them so that people can quickly make sense of the data that's flowing through consolidated logging. This data, we also sync for our partners to use in Iceberg. So for analytics, we have tables that contain all of the consolidated logging events, but we also provide the ability to extract, project, and filter sections of this data that are used for different downstream use cases. And one of those that I showed before is these real-time data services, things like Fluid or other systems that we have that can capture maybe the history of impressions that a profile has been shown. And all of these real-time data services are more and more starting to become part of the Netflix product. So for me, it's very interesting to see how data engineering used to be something that was mostly offline, mostly batch, and now it's starting to become more closely integrated with how our product behaves. So it's more in the critical path. I want to recap by saying there are a lot of tools, like Chris showed at the beginning. We only showed you a few of them, and some of those from our perspective, you will be hearing a lot more in talks that are going to be coming up next. One specifically that I want to call out is a system called Data Mesh. I was talking about building real-time data pipelines, and I feel like I was talking about how my team built real-time data pipelines, which is roughly at a very low level. We try to stay at a low level of abstraction. But at Netflix, we have solutions from our platform teams that are also at a very high level of abstraction. And one of those is Data Mesh. And you're going to hear more about that in a following talk. That's all. Thank you for your attention. I hope you learned something today. And we will be happy to answer any questions that you have.